as Dmitry Medvedev promised never to give back Crimea, the province's Muslim minority Tatars are deeply concerned. 70 years ago, during World War II, the Soviet leader Joseph Stalin forcibly deported them all. They started coming back to Crimea after the USSR collapsed, and later they voted to be part of independent Ukraine, not Russia. As the world is now forced to grapple with a new post-Cold War order after the annexation, the Crimean Tatar leader Mustafa Zhemilev is taking a plea and a warning to the United Nations. Don't set a dangerous precedent. Don't stand international order on its head, he told us in an exclusive interview just before his address in New York. Mustafa Zhemilev, welcome to the program.
Good afternoon.
Let me ask you first, have the Crimean Tatars decided to accept Russia's annexation or do something different to resist? What is your decision?
We can't actually oppose Russian military. There are only 300,000 of us. We're only 14% of the population of the peninsula. We have traditionally fighting for our rights in a democratic way, not applying any violence. Naturally, we don't accept this occupation. We insist on the integrity of our country, of Ukraine. The thing is that referendum which were held executed by occupational forces on the 16th of March, we didn't participate in that. We boycotted it. Not only us boycotted it, but many others, also ethnic Ukrainians and ethnic Russians, though the official authorities claimed that officially 82% of Crimean population voted. But in fact, we do have evidence that only 32.4% a percent of Crimean people voted. According to our data, which is quite precise, only 0.5% of Crimean Tatars took part in that referendum.
So what is happening to Tatars in Crimea right now? Are they being respected?
This situation is very concerned. We're very concerned because local government created so-called paramilitary units, Cossacks, others patrolling the streets. They're quite blunt, and the talks about second deportation of Crimean Tatars. Moreover, then from time to time, some symbols appearing on Crimean Tatar houses where they live. And it's we take it as a signal that some violence could start.
Have you spoken to President Putin? And what has he told you about the rights of Tatars under what he claims now, Russian Crimea?
We had a half an hour talk. I told Mr. Putin that we do not accept this planned forthcoming referendum because it's an absurd referendum under an occupational regime, and this regime contradicts some elementary basic norms. But still, President Putin was insisting that the opinion of Crimean people should be consulted.
So just to be clear, you would rather be part of Ukraine or part of Russia?
23 years ago, when Ukraine declared its independence, at our National Congress stated, we see our future as a national territorial autonomy within the framework of Ukrainian states. Any claims on the territory of Ukraine, with any references to any referendums, we will not accept them. And as general annexation of any part of Ukraine will violate international laws and will result in large-scale conflicts. That's why we believe that Russia should pull out its troops as soon as possible and respect the territorial integrity of our country.
Do you believe that Putin will go any further in taking or occupying or annexing any other parts of Ukraine?
As far as whether the Russians move further, I would believe that would be very unreasonable from the side of Russia, because there's a decision by the Ministry of Defense of Ukraine, no matter how weak we were military in comparison to Russia, but they will start fire, will open fire if army will move further, and it's hardly within the Russia's interest or President Putin's interest, but we can't exclude anything. But all this will result in bloodshed.
What are you asking the United Nations for today? What is your message?
I want to raise concern about the in connection with talks of politicians, of others, that being Crimea has been already lost, and measures should be taken for Russian troops not to move any further. From our point of view, that would be a direct violation of Budapest agreements of 1994, when great powers guaranteed our territorial integrity, and it would be a great tragedy for all Crimean people, not only for Crimean Tatars, but also for ethnic Ukrainians and tens of thousands of ethnic Russians who do not accept the Russian citizenship. In addition to that, I would like to raise my concern that those sanctions applied so far, they feel like some pin touches.
What do you make of the Western response to the annexation of Crimea?
In the United Nations, I met Mr. Erdogan, the leader of the Turkish Republic. The Turkish position is about that they are ready to take any measures, but as NATO member, they will not go. They will not take these measures on their own. I would like to say that biggest concern is about the possibility of clashes, of a large-scale bloodshed in Crimea. That's why the Majlis of the Crimean Tatar people requested for United Nations troops to be dispersed and on the Crimean. But we believe that this should be done.
And finally, as part of the agreement that guaranteed Ukrainian territorial integrity in 1994, Ukraine gave up its huge stockpile of nuclear weapons. Do you think Russia would have entered Crimea if Ukraine was still a nuclear power?
Of course not. Because it's very dangerous to act lawless against nuclear powers. That's why all these talks that we can put up with the loss of territory of Ukraine. This is as a cheating of Ukrainian people. If it happens that way, there won't be any trust towards international agreements. And now there's a talk in the parliament in order to apply all efforts for Ukraine to become again a nuclear power, no matter how much is needed. I'm confident that if we're nuclear power, that wouldn't have happened.
Mustafa Jamilev, thank you very much indeed for joining me.
Thank you.